Digital 410 Productions proudly presents the What's in Your Head podcast.
Digitized live from the ACT Computer Studios in Cape Coral, Florida, it's the What's in Your Head podcast with your hosts Gordon and Don Abernathy.
What's up, what's up, what's up, OG5? It's Tuesday and we're all back together for another fun-filled, excellent, somewhat mediocre night of the What's in Your Head podcast.
Somewhat, but it's way mediocre.
Okay, the way mediocre What's in Your Head podcast. And joining us, as always, from Las Vegas, Nevada, Gordon Abernathy. Gordon, how are you doing tonight, sir?
I am doing good. I had an interesting run-in with a, I'll just say it, homeless person.
Well, before we get that story, let's introduce our guest so he's not waiting in the wings.
Okay.
Joining us.
No, I really want to hear this homeless person.
We'll get right to it. But joining us from Texas, once again, friend of the show, Mr. RJ Nevens. RJ, how you doing tonight?
What's going on?
We don't care. We got to get to the homeless story. Gordon, go.
Right.
So I work for a predominant contractor here in the Las Vegas Valley, and our offices are located over what's now right next to Allegiant Stadium, which they get the benefits of, you know, doing some paid parking with. And with that, they've added a bunch of lights around the building.
Benefits? Well, has
a lot of lights. I'm talking a lot of lights. It's for security. It is, you know, kind of company that could be robbed for valuable commodities.
Would you say it's careful. Equal to or exceeding the light level of my neighbor's UFO house?
Oh, it's exceeding. It's exceeding to the point that it has caused a small confrontation between this homeless gentleman and about four or five employees.
Well, you know, floodlights do brighten up a tent on the inside, and depending on the color of said tent, if it's like a pink or a fuchsia or maybe a teal green, it can make a little uncomfortable ambiance in the middle of your tent at 3 a.m. So I can kind of understand.
Well, I had pulled in. I heard this has happened once, and I had pulled in and getting out of the car and shuffling my way in the work, as one would do at 6:30 in the morning. And this gentleman comes up. I said, "Hey, can I talk to you?" I'm like, "Okay." This guy's got Beats headphones on. He's actually looking okay.
Like mine? The studio version?
Not the studio version, probably a little lower. But needless to say, he had to identify himself as his ethnic background homeless guy.
So he has the $250 headphones on being a homeless guy.
Yeah.
Where does one charge your Beats wireless headphones in a tent?
Well, it's not even a tent. That's the interesting thing. And he proceeded to tell me that he feels that those in our building had decided to put this light up to shine down on his place he squats out, which is on a balcony in the building behind us.
So let me just make sure we're all on the same page here. According to this gentleman of the wild, he thinks that your business spent, let's say a couple of $1,000s on labor and equipment to install light strictly for the purpose of inconveniencing him.
100%. Now, it is a temporary light.
Sound business plan.
The wall.
Sound business plan.
Yeah, exactly. And he said, "I've lived here for 4 years. Me and the building owner have an agreement." And I'm thinking, hey, building changed hands like last year. So I'm fucking doubting it, number one.
When you're in the street, you're not up to exactly.
And number two, you know, I'm like, listen, sir, it's just for security. Well, blah, blah, blah. And, he thinks he's basically being outed to get out of there, and I wanted to say, well, maybe it's time to move on, sir, because he proceeded to tell me that he's been homeless for 4 years and he's working on getting himself in the right direction. And I'm thinking, 4 years? I think that's set in concrete at this point. You know?
Yeah, sadly.
He's probably our age range, maybe a little older.
Wow.
And, but what's interesting is I had to run off a separate homeless guy later that day. Just tooling back across the lobby at one of our receptionists, said, "Hey, there's a guy out front. I don't know what he wants." And I said, "Oh, I'll go. You're a big guy. Go take care of him." I'm like, "Oh, okay."
Well, gee, thanks.
Well, I had my Boston Scally hat on, which evidently makes it look like I got some attitude. So I walked out there, and I look around the corner. There's a tweaky-looking white kid leaning up against the building, kind of squatted down. Thought it may have been our former guy for a little bit. Kind of looked the same.
Was he cupping a smoke? Was he cupping a smoke?
Yeah, not wearing Beats.
Yeah, no.
Not
Beats.
Wearing Beats, and I just looked at him and I said, in the famous, "Can I help you?" And he just looked at me and said, "Private property, move along." No problems with that kid, but man, that one guy, I saw him today. He walked by me. That other guy walked by me again this morning. Didn't say shit this time. But Yeah.
Excuse me, Generation Z Kyle here. I have to step out and ask you a question. Why do you hate homeless people, sir? They're just people who are down on their luck. Everybody knows it's because of high prices and rent in Vegas and California that if you landlords and property owners would just provide free housing, it wouldn't be an issue at all. Why do you hate homeless people?
Don't hate homeless people, Kyle. Homeless people hate themselves.
You know, luckily I don't have any negative run-ins with homeless people down here. Obviously, we have them. I did find one day
although I'm sorry. I do got a new saying is, you know, hey, people from California, please don't move here. But you're more than welcome to visit and kindly take a homeless guy back with you.
You know what the perfect use for homeless people is?
That's the motto in Texas as well.
That sounds
well. That's also say Californians get. Yeah, exactly. They're going to. Where at in Texas are you?
I'm in Houston.
Houston. Okay, so it's not Austin bad.
No,
yet,
he's in real Texas. He's not in.
I think
fake
we
Texas.
Just fired our election official here because she already there was 10,000 ballots that went missing for the primary election here, and so. Or an extremely liberal county judge who appointed this, an elected lady. She just resigned today because they found 10,000 ballots hidden after the election.
Oh, wow. Conveniently so, huh?
Here's the
or inconveniently
thing.
So.
Here's
I think
thing.
I saw Dan Crenshaw talk about something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, 6,000 of those ballots were for Democrats. 4,000 were for Republicans. So
hey, Gordon, turn your mic down just a smidge. Where does one hide 10,000 ballots? I mean, I'm sure they're a little bit thicker than a dollar bill, and now I've never had the luxury to have $10,000 bills stacked in front of me, but I'm sure, well, actually, ballots are probably a little bit bigger, but where does one, is that a duffel bag? Is that a suitcase, or is that a strictly?
I think they're on, like imagine a legal-sized piece of paper, I guess it's like 11 by 14.
So
each person that votes, there's two, because we had like 100 things to vote on in this primary, so it took up two pieces of paper.
So you're thinking a fat vanilla envelope.
So our voting machines.
Like this?
Yeah.
There you go. Our voting machines out here worked a little differently, and I think I almost trust them. So you go through your vote. You plug everything in, ask you to review your review. Then it says, please review the paper ballot as it prints. And you look over to the right, and it goes through.
Right.
And
if you get, yeah, that's how ours work. Yeah.
Would it be, for auditing purposes, would it be too much of a hassle that once you put in your giant Scantron card and it spits it out and you do what Gordon just said, that it would spit out a receipt of the results and you staple it to the hard copy that you submitted and then put that in the envelope so if they ever want to audit it, they can see that your handwritten version matches what the computer computed? Would that be a bridge too far and require way too much receipt paper?
No idea. We had to show an ID to vote this time, though. We actually had to literally hand the person
also
ID.
the voter suppression was in full force, huh?
You know,
yeah,
I don't
yeah.
You mean that ID that you have to have to function in life,
yeah,
right?
Well,
to cash a check,
right,
to get an electric bill, to have a place to live. Yeah.
Not only that, but remember when Obama was in office and they were going after Arizona because Arizona had the audacity to enforce federal law requiring IDs, and it's like,
yeah, right.
When I was a kid and I got pulled over my friend's car as a passenger in the state of Ohio, I was required over the age of 16 to have some sort of state ID. I wasn't voting. I was sitting in a car in my friend Chevy as he was driving down the street getting pulled over. So even at the age of 16, you know, you were, at least in Ohio, you're required to have some sort of identification.
We
so it only makes sense that when you're going to go vote.
Hey, sketchy skater punk.
Yeah, right. Oh, you got skates. Yeah. I was going to say earlier, you know what this is going to sound so bad. You know what the best use of a good homeless person is? You know how, like, when you empty out your closet and your dresser and you have the good intentions of dropping shit off down at Goodwill, but it sits in your trunk for 6 months or in the back of your truck in the cab because, well.
Your closet. I got a bag of shit in my closet right now. So this story.
I had some jeans. They were sitting in the back seat of my truck. And for 2 weeks, I just never, too busy, always forgot about them. And then I went downtown to take some stuff to the bar for my brother-in-law's wedding dinner at the time, and there was a young cat. I got down there at 10 and he was down there, and then, you know, and then I went back that night and he was still there. So I was like, oh, I got something for you. I went back to my car and just unloaded like 5 pairs of jeans. Sadly, they're like my fat jeans from when I was 38, not the age but the size, and this cat was like 32 and he's looking at him like, what the fuck am I going to do with these? Like, I got a belt.
Well, the problem is you're leaving money on the table.
Actually, that's when he turned around and said, do you have a belt? I'm like, no, No, I can't.
Did you ask him for a receipt so you can put it against your taxes?
I don't even do that.
I mean, that's will. Oh, you got to do that. I mean, and it's legit. If you're donating things, just get the receipt.
Come yeah, but on. I thought write-offs only count if they made up like 30% of your income or some shit like that.
If after I think if you're over 20,000, can you get that 20,000 deal? Anything over that kind of helps. So,
RJ, you were just in. You went dark. Like, I thought maybe you got shadow banned and kicked off all the platforms, and then I was texting you.
Not this time.
And then you hit me with the new phone, who dis? Gee, thanks for copying me to the SIM card, fella. I'm not even SIM card status, Gordon. I'm saved on phone contact.
Guys. Oh, hey, man. Let's talk about that. You pushed me to the SMS trash text message.
Yeah, so I'm not even at the level of SIM card contact. I'm saved to phone contact, but that's all right. I got the new phone. Who's this? And I was like, you want to come on the show? And he's like, well, technically, I can't do anything internet related for 30 days. I got something cool going on. Well, clearly, here you are on YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, and all the other places we're currently streaming to right now. So clearly, you've been released back to the world of the internet, but. What happened and exactly how did that go?
Good story. Chelsea saw, my wife saw an advertisement. She was watching Fox News, saw an advertisement for a contest from Kahlua, you know, Kahlua Rum.
Wait a minute. I'm sorry. It wasn't an advertisement for MyPillow and or the $50 vegetable fruit thing.
You know,
I'm convinced.
Dinovites. Don't forget Dinovites.
No, for like the last 3 weeks, the only commercials, I'm convinced that Fox News is funded by MyPillow and those fruits and vegetable pills. That's the only commercials they play.
That's all I see on there, too. It's amazing. It's like
the 40-year-old skateboarder.
The free thing of fruits and vegetable pills.
They sold me, and I went online. I was like, I want to get some of those Amazon. $150 up? No, I'm good. I'll just go buy some carrots. Thanks.
Yeah. So we made a video, and at the very last minute, we entered it into this contest, right? And so we just made a funny video as us rapping, kind of Beastie Boys style. It was actually really fun. When we did it, 11 o'clock at night, had it submitted by midnight, and lo and behold, they chose us to be the grand finalist. We were the only couple in North America chosen. So we were the chosen ones out of everybody that entered. All three people that entered, they chose us. I'm just kidding. I have no idea how many people entered. And the whole gist of the contest was from 6:30 p.m. to 6:30 a.m., we had to be internet free, off our phones, you know, no television, all that stuff. We just kind of had to go dark. And the whole thing, the whole, you know, gist of the contest was for us to reconnect with each other.
Aww.
It was pretty cool. I know. It was great.
And who was the sponsor for this?
Kahlua Rum.
Nice. Right.
So if you had TV that only streamed via the internet, was that also part of the mix?
Yeah, we couldn't do anything. The only thing they said we could do was if there was an emergency.
Watch Fox News?
Only if you had a MyPillow and you were giving your dog Dynavite.
And you're buying gold and silver.
Yeah, man. So pretty much everything was off the table. We couldn't do anything.
For 30 days.
For 30 days. And they sent us this huge box. I'm not kidding you, man. This thing is like, it looks like something, a band, like a roadie, wheels up on the stage. And it's about the size of a huge speaker box. It's almost 5 feet tall.
Like the crate in A Christmas Story that said Fragile on it?
Man, that's about how big it was. And it was, and it's awesome.
French for kick me!
It was awesome. And they had a, for each night, there was a different gift in there. So we would open up one of these gifts, and it could have been like Trivial Pursuit, or it could have been like, gosh, I don't know. It was all kinds of stuff, puzzles and all this other stuff. So it was stuff for us to do at night. It was like every night we had a date to do. It was pretty awesome. And so
did they have you filling out like a daily blog or a diary or something just to see how it was changing your life or affecting your relationship at all? Or was it just, no, we're going to trust you to do your thing?
Part of the big kit thing they sent us a Polaroid camera, and that's how we were documenting it at night. And the box was huge. It was, I mean, I was like, damn, did we get to keep this box? It was full of almost $4,000.
He's like a cat. You buy him all this shit and he just wants the box.
Yeah. I just wanted to get inside it like a little kid on Christmas. I don't care about the toys. I just want to get inside this box.
I'm gonna make myself a rocket.
And yeah, here's the funny thing. And oh, at the end of it, at the end of the 30 days, how they would kind of confirm that we didn't get on the internet and all this other stuff, they were going to send somebody to our house to give us a polygraph. Hmm. Very crazy, right? And of course, they had the ability to, if we failed something, some part of it, they had the ability to override it, right? But about 8 days into this contest, I got COVID. I'm still alive, guys. I made it.
Yep. All three of us have had it.
Right.
Yep.
We all made it. And so Chelsea mentioned to the guy who was, you know, kind of in contact with, like, oh, and Bob got COVID. This is great because we can just stay at home now. We're going to do all these things. This is great. The next day, they said, hey, can you guys hop on a Zoom call with us?
Uh-oh. You didn't read subsection 4-5.
No. So we did. And the first thing he said, the first thing him and his and the other lady on the phone said was, hey, we just want you guys to know that the grand prize was $25,000. So they were like, we just want you to know that the $25,000 is yours. But we're going to go ahead and just kind of cancel the contest because they wanted us to promote it and hashtag it, you know, and hype the media. And of course, you know, we signed over licensing rights and everything to the video we made. So I was suspecting that they
I don't
were
know why they would cancel it because of COVID though.
Well, I think the concern was that I was going to give it to Chelsea because we were doing these intimate little date night things. And then, you know, that 0.3% chance of Chelsea getting COVID and something bad actually happened.
So if I get this correct, you got this contest, you got COVID, didn't have to do the contest and still walked away with the money.
It was the easiest money in the world, man.
Jesus. Don, if it wasn't for bad luck, you, my man, would have none at all.
Well, it's just...
So they sent us the check. We cashed it. It actually cashed. It worked.
And so you only had to do 8 days out of 30?
Yeah. I mean, you know, Don's met my wife before. He knows how Chelsea is. Chelsea's like, oh, hell no.
We're doing it.
And that's good.
We're doing this. Yeah. And so we went ahead and did it. We made
You got to make it honest money, right?
Yeah, I mean, I would feel bad spending all that money and thinking, no, I'm just kidding. I would not feel bad. They, yeah, but I mean, we made a couple, like we watched the Super Bowl and I think we watched a couple like Pam and Tommy's, that documentary or not documentary, that show.
I have not seen that yet.
That's not a show, sir. That's a film.
It's a film, yes.
I
it's a
limited it
series. It's pretty good
now,
on that note.
I know your wife is more the social media butterfly and the poster and all that. How on day one, 6 a.m., you guys put your phones away, your tablets away, and this and that?
6 p.m.
6 p.m.
So it's nighttime. So half the time we're sleeping. That's, you know, that was great.
But the next
morning. No detox, no jitters.
Well, that's what I'm
no
getting
jitters,
to. That's what,
no.
I'm, that's what I'm getting to. The very next morning you wake up, and everybody's habit is to grab the phone, sit on the toilet and watch some TikToks or maybe check Instagram or whatever.
Yeah.
How good. I'm sure she had more withdrawal than you did.
I got to look at the damn shampoo bottles again.
Just like 1994. Nobody has magazines.
How do I pronounce these words?
Now moving on to the conditioner.
You know, it's
funny. See what the difference is.
You know, it's funny you say that because like the big TikTok trend now is everybody's realizing that their French vanilla is nothing but corn syrup with flavoring in it. And I bet somebody's battery was dead and they're on the way to the bathroom. They just grabbed that sumbitch off the counter, sat down and started reading and said,
oh, man.
Honey, where's the Reader's Digest at?
Turn your mic down just a little bit, Gordon.
If I had to read shampoo bottles, I don't know about you guys, but my wife has about 50 different types of conditioners.
And all of them are...
That's a novel.
And all of them are empty.
I don't know why. It's like a different chapter.
And all of them are empty, and they're sitting in the bottom of your shower.
It's like, I just have Head and Shoulders. Shit, that's all I need. I'm like, why do you need 14 different bottles of shampoo?
Have you guys ever gotten to the... I have the glass sliding shower doors, but since I'm tall,
yes,
there's like a 3-4 foot gap above the top, and I'll get in there and I'll reach out for shampoo, empty. I just start lobbing them over the door into the bathtub like grenades. Empty.
Yeah.
Empty. How many goddamn... So by the time I'm out of there's 3 bottles left because there's 6 empty ones stacked up in the bathtub that I bounced off my wall.
Honey, I don't know what happened, but I'm all out of shampoo and hair products now.
But did she... Was the first day kind of rough for the two of you?
I mean, honestly, I don't think it was. I mean, I think the big thing was that I just started a new job So I had to, so nighttime was, you know, I'm used to working 24/7, no matter kind of what I'm doing. And, yeah, so that was pretty interesting. Yeah. But that's the only thing about it.
I was going to say, I bet after like day five or six, you guys were just like, God, this is fucking awesome. It reminds us when we were teenagers again.
Yeah. I mean, it was kind of like that. Actually, we were going to bed at like 8 o'clock at night and sleeping until 6 or 7 the next morning. I mean, I got so much good sleep. I mean, I have to say, we told the Kahlua people this too, like, yeah, and that's the reason why we wanted to go all the way through it is like, man, we just wanted to see what it was like to be completely disconnected, at least just for those 12 hours out of the day. And it was fantastic.
And then
if you think about it, Kahlua had a little extra money to spend because of the spike in alcohol sales during COVID.
Oh, I know.
So they give a little away.
And then the day he logs on, what's going on in Ukraine? Holy shit. Turn the phone back off.
No, fuck. We're sliding into World War III real quick. Got to make a new documentary. All right.
You know, I said it before. That's one of the top five lists of my favorite things when I go out and do those World War II weekends. Is it's the only time that my family and everybody knows that I won't be answering texts. Leave me a voicemail. I'll get up. I'll pull my phone out of my pocket maybe once every 3 hours, turn it on. If I'm in a location, actually get signal.
Right.
I'll check my voicemail, but I'll pull it out long enough to take some photos, and then I won't upload anything until, you know, I'm done with that week. And it's so nice to, A, not be on the phone all day. Two, we're outside for 48 hours straight. Three, when the sun goes down, you're sitting around a campfire all night. You throw back some booze and you go pass out in a tent on the ground for a few hours. You get up and do it all over again. It's a good time.
It's the reason I like to disappear to the mountains for a little bit.
Mm-hmm. You know, you were talking about homeless earlier. Oh, real quick, I went to the gym tonight before the show.
Yeah, I thought you were cutting it kind of close. I saw that check-in. I was like, he's either going to be really tired or amped up.
Well, I did the same thing last night. We had Scott Gibson from HBS The Pacific on the What's the Scuttlebutt last night, and I did like a 35-minute session on my mixed fitness bike just to wake me up and get me going. But I don't know if this is a result of the pandemic. I don't know if this is a result of me after 13 years leaving the old man cardio gym known as Planet Fitness and going to Crunch Fitness. It could be a little bit of both, but one thing I've noticed at Crunch Fitness, and it's a great thing, I'm not knocking it at all, it's super crowded, but there seems to be a lot more 16 to 23-year-old cats hitting the gym, guys and girls. I don't know if it's because you're starting to see more and more like CrossFit chicks and shit on Instagram, or maybe this younger generation, they don't want to be the obese Americans that, you know, we're all blamed to be. But I'm starting, and it's a good thing, you know, because we're all somehow kids don't move, they don't worry about, they're all busy playing Xbox. I would say the gym was clear assholes to elbows tonight, and I would say 60% of them were young cats. And it's
maybe
like,
it's a lot of Joe Rogan listeners, you know, he's got a big base and he preaches it, so
it could be, or you know, it could be, you know, maybe some of these cats are actually watching a pandemic and hearing that, you know, it's all the heavy set kids, or maybe it's just the generation swings the other way, you know, they don't want to be like their generation. Not the millennial brothers. I don't know, but I'm seeing a lot more young cats in the gym, and it's like fucking sweet.
We just joined a new gym. We kind of got rid. We were at Snap Fitness for the longest time, and Chelsea didn't like it anymore. We'd been there for a couple years actually, so we just joined. I think it's called Fitness Project. It's a pretty good place.
Isn't it weird after you've been going to the gym for a long ass time, and even if you go visit with on somebody else's pass, you just, especially like in the freeway area, you just feel like you're in the way because you're not familiar with the environment. You don't know really where can I stand to be out of everybody's way.
Yeah.
It takes
you're
like
the,
a
you're
good,
the new guy, right?
It takes you like a good 2 weeks to get comfortable working out in those areas.
No, that's true, man. I completely agree with that. Yeah, it takes a minute to figure out where everything is. And dude, this Fitness Project place is huge. There's different areas, you know, and all kinds of stuff. They have classes. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool. But yeah, I totally get it. It took me a couple weeks to settle in.
Yeah, heck, part of that's just the vibe of the people around you, just trying to figure out, you know, who is what. I know
I just wasn't used to all the girls flirting with me. That's the thing.
The thing that caught me off guard at Crunch is they have one of the Bikram yoga rooms, right? The hot yoga where it's like 128 degrees, whatever the fuck it is in there. But they keep the heater on even when there's no class. I guess they have to maintain that heat because I guess it would take too long. But you figure, well, if I got class on Monday at 9 a.m., let's just turn the heat on at 11 p.m. on Sunday night. But there's a sign that says, please keep the door shut. Even if there's no one in here, we have to keep the heat on, like, all the time, which just seems weird and like a waste of energy to me. But
I mean, the environmental went insane.
Yeah. Oh, and plus, you know, when it's summertime there, I'm sure it's not a lot of energy that it really takes to get it up that extra 3 degrees than outside.
I haven't looked in there, but it almost looks like they got, like, cedar planks or, like, wood on
and
the
wall. And
that
may be why it's got to stay seasoned to the condition of the rooms, or it'll start warping or cracking, you know.
You and Chelsea posted, it's so great when you guys do your Instagram videos or whatever, because they have your directorial flair on them. It's just not some boring old video. It looks like you spent at least 20 minutes in the edit bay. You guys were out doing some hiking out around Texas. Was that in Texas?
Yeah, man. Isn't that crazy that exists in Texas?
Yeah.
That's Big Bend National Park. We went there actually last year, I think. I forgot when it was. It was right when
that's right down on the border, right?
Yeah, it's literally on the border, man. And it is beautiful down there, man. It is like the Grand Canyon. And there's this really pretty place down there called Terlingua. And it's, I think, whatever the stargazing scale is, it's like number one in the stargazing scale. I mean, you can sit outside. We sat outside so many nights and just, like, watch the Milky Way above us. Man,
I could actually see the Milky Way.
Yeah, I mean,
like,
it was
when I was a kid. Oh, yeah.
You guys do quite a bit of traveling. Is that primarily you or Chelsea, or the both of you who just likes to get out and go?
It's mainly Chelsea. She really likes to get out and go places. I mean, I'm fine with doing it too. She would go everywhere. Of course, you know, her job allows her to, because she can work from home. I mean, we go down to Terlingua. We were down in Big Bend. She was working, you know, so it's easier for her. Man, but that place is great.
Chelsea's constantly checking the Starlink map to figure out when she can go to fucking the rainforest and be able to get a good signal on her laptop.
Right.
Ukraine, here we come.
Yeah, no, we did a lot of hiking down in Big Bend. There were some really good hikes there, and really, really good places. There was one point, I can't remember the name of the trail we were on, but we ran across like four or five black bears. They were literally no joke 30 feet from the path, and we just walked right on past them.
Hi, bear. Yeah,
there's nothing.
I tell you, when I was in Montana, we'd have some black bears. This is in Big Sky. We have some black bears come down there and in the tourist area, the base area, and as an employee, we basically run them off like a dog.
Yeah, you know, the black bears really aren't.
I got to run this funny looking dog off. Don't pin it between cars taking pictures either. That's not going to end well for you.
Yeah. Montana's beautiful too, man.
Oh, I miss it.
Martin is checking in from New York. He said, COVID is gone in New York City. Finally, I guess they're finally lacking up on their mask mandates. You know, after the Ukraine thing started, and about time, you know, we're seeing all these, you know, State of the Union addresses and all these videos of Biden and Psaki and Harris and stretch face Pelosi. They're up at the podium. They've all gotten rid of the mask, which is great. About fucking time. But it still amazes me now that we've gotten to that point that there's still these big corporate chains that are making their employees still wear the goddamn mask. It's like, okay, the president's not even doing the ruse anymore. You're still gonna make your barista wear the mask. I was telling Gordon the other day, RJ, I went through the drive-through, and the barista had a mask on. He had like the mask made out of like the Wickaway gym shirt, but then it was like perforated with like teardrop air holes in the front. It's like, I get it, what he's doing, you know, he has to wear it, but it's just like, come on. I mean, if you're at the point where you're wearing a mask with holes in it, just take the fucking
thing
off.
Even the CDC has pretty much said, these things are worthless. Wait, didn't you say that at the beginning, too?
Yeah, that's an interesting, you know, my whole story with that is pretty crazy. I've got a long history with the whole vaccine mandate and all that other stuff. It's, you know, I was, unfortunately, I was probably one of, if not the first person fired in America for not getting the vaccine. I worked for Houston Methodist Hospital. They were the first private company in America to mandate the vaccine. And that was back in April.
Thus the cool shirt, huh?
Thus the cool shirt. Yeah, this is what? Some of my nurse friends there who left and filed the lawsuit along with me and some of those other nurses against the hospital.
Well, and that's just it. I was wondering how this is going to, how they're going to square everything if they're getting rid of all the vaccine mandates. And, you know, those who rode through without getting it is like, hey, I'm good. And it's like, well, you know, what about the people that are forced? Does it give them any cause? You know, what's going to happen? It's quite interesting.
Well, you know, our lawsuit right now, it was dismissed by the trial judge down here. We have a mass action.
It's so crazy this is happening in Texas, by the way, but go ahead.
Yeah, you would have never thought it. I mean, it's like, you know, I ran so fast to get to Texas, and then all of a sudden it's like clamped down.
The problem is you don't live in Fort Worth, son.
Oh, gosh. That's Tarrant County and Fort Worth. That's probably even more liberal than
– Really?
Than Harris County. Yeah, it's pretty liberal up in the Dallas area. I mean, Harris County's, you know, Texas is weird, right? Because it's the major cities are all super blue, right? When you look at the chart. Just like America. And once you get out of those like urban areas, I mean, it's all red. It's amazing. Our lawsuit was dismissed initially by Judge Hughes here in town, who is, by the way, the most overturned judge out there. And so, we filed an appeal, and it's sitting over in the Fifth Circuit Court over in New Orleans, and we're just waiting for those appellate judges. We filed our brief. Houston Methodist filed their brief. Now they're just sitting. They've had Methodist briefs, or their response to our brief, probably now for close to a month. And so we're expecting those judges. They'll either come back. Three things are going to happen, right? They'll either come back and side with us, they'll side against us, which either way, if it happens, it's going to be appealed. You know, if they side against us, we'll appeal it. If they side for Methodists, we'll appeal it. Or they'll call for oral arguments, and then our attorneys get to go down there and fight it out in front of the judges. So that's kind of what I want.
Well, and that's what's interesting. When that last big lawsuit got kicked from the 5th to the 6th up in Cincinnati, which had more conservatives on it, that's our hometown, I was surprised that it didn't go the way that the conservatives would hope.
And, I mean, I don't have a lot of faith in our courts right now. They're especially saying the Supreme Court, even though they struck down some of those mandates, they kept the one for healthcare workers for some odd reason or another.
And that's the insanity too. It's like you hear these stories where, oh, we fired all these nurses who refused to get the jab, but then they're like, okay, those of you who got COVID and got sick, come on back and go to work.
It's the weirdest thing. And, you know, it's just kind of a clusterfuck of people who got caught up in front of it really quick. And, you know, a lot of people, even back in early 2020, they started using it for a political purpose. I mean, I can't tell you how many times Governor Abbott and some of the other folk, Congressman Al Green and Sheila Lee Jackson and all these ridiculous idiots down here, were walking the halls of Houston Methodist with, you know, our the leaders of that hospital. So, I mean, there's certain things there.
I tell you, I feel like I was coerced by my sleep doctor. Because I've got
than
a
being
few...
molested by your sleep doctor.
Well, I ended up with...
Oh, my God, that's a story. Let's hear it.
No, well, I ended up with a jab, but it was because... I was kind of watching the comorbidity scale, right?
Right.
So I had a few things going on, and I've got a CPAP machine. I'm heavy, but everything else is actually fairly healthy with me. But I had a really bad, what I thought was allergies last year. It was horrible from like beginning at this time of the year through July or so. And I went to my sleep doctor. I noticed he was an allergy doctor. Also said, hey, while I'm here, you know, blah, blah, blah. He said, oh, yeah, you know, you got asthma. Like, asthma? What are you talking about? He goes, it's all over your record. I'm like, I got allergic rhinosinusitis. Come to find out, I don't have that either. But, you know, this and that. And I'm like, okay, maybe my comorbidity is getting there. If I croak, it's not going to do my wife any favors. So I'll go ahead and do it. Got the jab. 3rd of July weekend here in Vegas. 4 days later, come down with Delta.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. Then I ended up. I was doing the online deal with the doctors and the PAs, and like, you know, go on down to the urgent care just to get checked out because of this and this. And I did, and they wanted to give me the monoclonals, which I'm like stoked. Okay, cool. They're like, oh, Do you have clots? I was like, well, I did have some veins ablated earlier in the year.
That sounds
the year before, which I concerned it clotting as a side effect of that and thrombosis. Yeah, sure. So I said, okay. And they're like, okay, we've got to get you a CT scan. Okay, it's 117 degrees outside. They couldn't give me a CT scan because the room was too hot. Mm-hmm. They couldn't get it cooled enough. Mm-hmm. So I ended up going to the emergency room and at a hospital that I chose. And I went in, and it was like a bomb went off. All the testing went great. They went to give me the CT scan. He hit me with the image. The iodine didn't even kick in until after the image was almost done. So his timing was off. And they're talking to me, and they're like, you know, we're going to check you in because, you know, your creatine levels are a little elevated. Your D-dimer is a little elevated. We just want to keep an eye on you. So I ended up in the hospital over the weekend. Come to find out, I was looking at my previous Quest diagnostic stuff. My creatine's been a little elevated. I may have to get that checked out. But needless to say, I ended up with it and got the monoclonal. When I got the monoclonal, my temperature that night spiked to 104.5.
Oh, man.
So we called the hospital back, and they're like, just put them in ice water in the bathtub. If it doesn't come down, come in. It came down real quick.
Oh, shit, no, the ice maker's broke.
It came down real quick and didn't have a fever, but did feel like garbage. Yeah. So while we had COVID, we decided to watch Black Sunday, and that's a little weird. Mm-hmm. When you're feeling like garbage and you're watching a zombie-type pandemic, as Don would say, that nobody's held precious there.
No.
And got through it. But, yeah, I just felt like at the end of the day, him telling me I had asthma when I've gone to two allergists since then, and they're like, no, you don't have asthma. Actually, you don't even hardly have allergies. It's just what we call dust. It's an irritant. So went through all that to say, I feel like I was a little pushed because that guy was very pro. But three of my other medical doctors, including two PAs and a infectious disease guy, said, don't take the second dose. They're three here in Vegas. And I did go against them because, you know, my wife did get it. And I'm like, well, shit, she's doing it. I better do it, too. Cause they ain't gonna
hear there's so many. I know so many people that have gotten the jabs. A lot of people I know haven't opted to get the booster. They just see no reason to get it.
No boosters for me. Right? Just
and, you know, honestly, 98% of those people I'd say that I know that went out and got the jabs, I'm fine.
I'm fine too. No weird things.
A couple people I know had like some shingles side effects. A few people I know came down with like 3 days later after getting the second jab, had a Bell's palsy reaction and fell out. Yeah, that actually happened to Alan West. You know, he was in the primary. He was going to run for governor here against Abbott. And, you know, he's been at some of our events that we've had for, you know, raising money and everything. And, you know, his daughter, she took the jab and she fell out in church with, you know, Bell's palsy side effect. So, you know, that stuff does happen. It's few and far between. But when somebody, I think, is telling you that you have to take it, I was at my job for 10 years whenever they told me to take it. I was like, you know, I'm just not. And this was in April of 2020. That's right when Johnson & Johnson was, you know, all the blood clotting issues and everything were coming out. And, I'm like, you know what? I think I'll pass. You can just go ahead and fire me.
Well, one thing. Yeah, absolutely. One thing I've thought about is people who did get it like myself and then ended up with Delta. It almost seems like a whoo for the drug companies, even though they can't be sued anyway, because now they say, well, how do you know that came from the vaccine? Maybe it came from the COVID you had.
Yeah, you know? Well, that's the thing is you don't, I mean, and that's one of the big things about COVID is I don't think when you get it, you don't necessarily know who you got it from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because I slept with my wife and I slept in the same bed when I had it.
Yep, same here.
You know, and everything. And she never got it.
That's the way we were. Carrie got it was the original variant because she got it early. And I didn't get it. And then I ended up with what we believe was the Delta variant and she didn't get it. I don't know if this is a symptom of long hauler or maybe I'm just getting old and delicate in my age. But within like the last 3 months, I've noticed now. And I used to be one of these cats. I would wear like the Nautica Sport body spray or the Old Spice body spray. I've noticed, and it hit me at the gym tonight. It hits me when I go to the grocery store and I'm around old ladies. I don't know if this is a long hauling thing from COVID or once again, I'm just getting delicate in my old age, but now anytime I smell any cologne or perfume, it just smells like someone's covered in, they're like, to me, it smells like their clothes got cat piss on it and they're spraying the perfume to cover it up. All I smell is the cat piss smell for some reason. I don't know why.
Oh, really?
Never happening before until like the last 3 months. I was at the gym tonight. Dude walked
by. There's a lot of tweakers running around your neighborhood.
No, and like a lot of it's these old ladies who they wear this perfume.
Spinsters.
Or if I walk down the shampoo and deodorant aisle and body spray aisle at Publix, it smells like cat piss, and I do not know why. It's never been an issue.
Your smell?
2 months. What's that?
Did you lose your smell or your taste?
No, not at all. And that's the weird thing. Carrie did. She did the whole bit into the onion thing. For her, when she first lost her smell, everything smelled like an ashtray. And then even worse, it converted to everything smelled like your clothes after you've been sitting around a campfire all weekend. So for like 2 months, only thing she could smell is campfire smell.
That's similar to Katina. She lost her smell worse than I did. But for the longest time until about recently, any type of meat we'd cook would smell rotten to her.
Ugh. Let me ask you this. You got kids, don't you, RJ?
Yeah, they're grown. But yeah, I've got grandkids now.
Okay, how old are your grandkids?
Let's see. I think Blakelyn is 4.5, and then little Houston is. I think he'll be 2 in December.
Okay, they're a little young, but so we know last 2 years schools have been shut down. Even here in Florida for, a year they were, and they're doing the online schooling, and everything was all COVID all the time, so they weren't concerned about scaring the shit out of kids, right? My daughter is 14 and middle school, and she just keeps coming home oblivious about the Ukraine thing. And I asked her tonight at dinner, I was like, do they talk about Ukraine at school at all? No, somebody brought up in science class, and we were told it's not appropriate for school.
Oh, so that's the bigger, scarier story that you don't want to fill them with, unlike COVID?
That's kind of my point. It's like my first instinct is to be a little annoyed and pissed off that they don't want to talk about such a important current event at school. But then the other side of me is saying, well, is that where I want her to hear about it? Is from from school, where a lot of those people may have some leanings that I don't
really
enjoy.
Have they brought back duck and cover?
But yeah, she said that they don't talk about school. It's not appropriate conversation for school. It's like the biggest world event.
Appropriate.
Yeah,
I think it's kind of odd, weird, funny, whatever the term, that so many people are just like, I stand with Ukraine, and I get it, right? They're being attacked. They didn't do anything. They had free elections. You know, Zelensky was duly elected. You know. But it's interesting because, now Zelensky and the government are handing their citizens machine guns, weapons, AKs, whatever it may be. And most of the people on the far left side, right, they're like, I stand with Ukraine. And it's like, well, what if we were getting attacked and our government was handing out guns?
Yeah. It is ironic.
I think they would be for it then. And that's just the thing that drives me nuts is the same people who are against guns are for this. I'm like, well, you're not being very genuine, because these people in Ukraine who weren't allowed to have firearms would actually be a lot more proficient if they had firearms and they were able to practice and go out instead of shooting their foot when they first get it.
Yeah, and that's a good point. A lot of the people in the reenacting world, they acquire the M1 Garands through a program that was actually was passed by Congress after World War I. It's called the Civilian Marksmanship Program. And the whole concept was let's teach our civilians how to be marksmen in case we ever have a world war on our soil. This is prior to World War II. Our people would be able to defend themselves. And throughout the country, they would have shooting competitions, and you could get military surplus weapons at a discounted rate. Now, obviously, you're not going to go on there and buy M16s, but to this date, you can go on to CMP.com, and depending on their availability, you can get M1 Garands, you can get M1 Carbines. For a while, they imported a bunch of 1911s from Korea that were in warehouses. Those sold out like freaking quick, but they still have the CMP, the Civilian Marksmanship Program, is still a thing. No one knows about it outside the World War II and the M1 Garand collecting community, but that was something our Congress did, is we need to encourage our people to be proficient with firearms for national defense.
And at the very least, it would make good hunters out of them, right? They could mm-hmm. actually hit their target, which actually brings me to something I think is weird. So back in Ohio and in Kentucky, you had to wear the blaze orange with your shit, right?
Yeah.
Out here in Nevada, nope. You are as camoed as camoed can be. No yeah. orange anywhere. Well,
I think the yeah. argument could be made, though, is the your Nevadas, your Colorados, your Texas.
It's more spread out.
It's wide, yeah. wide, sparse, whereas in your Kentucky, the Ohio, Illinois, you got a bunch of people in small acreage of public land all fighting for the same 23 deer. And
they're out there deer hunting on 2 acres.
Yeah, exactly. And if you watch Meat Eater... If you watch Meat Eater, he grew up in Michigan. He talks about, you know, yeah. the horrible deer hunting back then. Let's change up a little bit. Here's something we haven't done in a while. Let's see. Episode board. Here we go.
You ever have that thing where you think you know someone as well as you could possibly know anyone, and then one day you were totally wrong?
It was something, what your mom did.
You don't have much time. You have to leave. You can't talk to anyone, okay? No calls, no texting, nothing. There are just some things you don't understand.
Every time I think I get closer to knowing her, she slips away.
We all do things we'd rather forget.
Mom, just tell me the truth.
Who are you?
The Netflix series Pieces of Her follows the story of Andy, who is caught in a deadly mass shooting at a local diner. Moments later, she witnesses her mother, Laura, violently eliminating the threat with ease. As Andy begins to unravel her mother's actions on that very day, her perspective of their entire family relationship takes a new turn. Soon after, figures from her mother's past reappear, and as she is forced to escape, while on her journey, she attempts to piece together the remnants of truth of her mother's long-buried past. This is a great show. We just finished. I don't know if the season...
That's a great elevator pitch.
I don't know if season 2's a thing. Stars Toni Collette. You guys probably know her from, what was that, The Many Minds of Tara, where she was like a schizophrenic. That was on HBO.
Oh, United States of Tara.
Yeah,
Tara.
United States.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Bella Heathcote plays Andy, her daughter. Omar Hardwick is Gordon Oliver, Laura's ex-husband. David Wayman is Jasper, her brother.
Wait a second.
And Joe Dempsey. For some reason, they don't give credit to one of the main stars who plays on Yellowstone as the archetype on the Native American side. He plays a huge role. For some reason, on this Wikipedia, they don't give him any credit. But the acting is fantastic. There's a lot of suspense. This is one of those shows that's hard to talk about without giving it away, because as soon as the thing starts. But the things it's got going for it. Right now, the young kids love the 1980s. The mother's backstory takes place around in 1988. So there's a lot of 80 flashback stuff. It's interesting. They incorporate a lot of the 80s anti-yuppie culture and the anti-Reagan stuff. That plays a big part of it. It's, as you heard, it's a suspenseful thriller, and they do a very... This is one of those shows where there's no defined bad guy. You know, like episode like 1 through 5, they'll start to develop a character you think is the bad guy, and the character you think is a good guy. Then around episode 6 through 8, it starts to transition. So by the end of the season, you don't know who you feel sorry for and who the bad guy and who the good guy is. We all know Toni Collette is a fantastic actress. Everybody, top down, all the actors in this are very, very good. There's a few things, you know, the suspension of belief you got to do with. But if you guys are looking for a good thriller to watch on Netflix, check out Pieces of Her. That is my suggestion for this week's Netflix binge-worthy show of the week. And like I said, it's really hard It's one of those shows you just don't want to give too much away because you don't want to spoil all the twists and turns.
Very good. Real quick drink check. I noticed RJ has a...
Yeah, I noticed that earlier too.
What are you drinking today? Don's got Larceny. There you go.
What is that?
It is Duke's Kentucky Bourbon.
Yeah, you got to forgive me. I'm looking at a monitor that's 12 feet away from me, so that's why my eyes are casting up.
Very good. I've just got Dewar's and some AK-47 coffee.
So that's like John Wayne Duke?
Yeah, and it was actually, when we were on set for a Walking Point, Ed, you know, the star of Walking mm-hmm. Point was a dog named Duke, and so Ed gave us this this bottle. So I just took a picture of it and texted it to him. I always let them know when I'm drinking it.
You know.
Oh, very good. So for our new listeners out there, can you let them know where you can find Walking Point? Is it still out there? Is it still available?
Yeah, it is. It's still out on Amazon Prime. We just finished our very last film festival. You know, COVID kind of knocked us out of the entire film festival run. We did a lot of online festivals, which is not the same. But out of all the festivals, I think we probably hit about 30 or so of them and won dozens of awards out of it. And we just finished up in Austin at the Austin Revolution Film Festival, where we were kind of honored to bring home the best military themed film.
And for local Very news, good. For those of you watching here in Southwest Florida, the ending half of that movie was filmed out on Boquilla, actually technically St. James City area. So if you want to. Like,
shout out to Palm Cove.
Palm Cove, absolutely. And that's where I met up with you guys, and we spent the day out there. And that rap party was still one of my most enjoyable on-site interviews I've ever done for the What's the Scub Up podcast. And I just love looking at those pictures and going back to that night. That was a good time.
Yeah, it was so much fun. I mean, we were so lucky to have folks like, just everybody, to have Obi and Fumi, who were our Japanese actors, to join us. I mean, they flew in all the way from LA just to be a part of it. It's amazing. That was a fun party, though.
Are you currently working on any new screenplays, or are you just kind of chilling for a while?
No, I've got a couple in the works.
That 30 days may have given him an opportunity.
I know. You know what? And I told myself, I'm going to write like a son of a bitch in those 30 days. And I did not touch a page.
That's how it usually works out.
I know. I just couldn't find the motivation.
Well, I was going to say that's one of those things you really can't push the envelope. You can't force that sort of writing, or it comes off so labored and just kind of pandering almost.
From a screenwriting standpoint, I mean, my part is, I can't get out there and write until you just kind of feel it. And then, you know, I'll go 30 days without writing anything. Then I'll knock out 15 pages, which is, you know, a fifth of a script.
Just got to let it develop naturally, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes I do an outline, sometimes I don't, but I'm working on a script right now with a comedian. His name's Tommy Barrett. And ironically, he also played the serial killer in a film that we did a long time ago called Tartarus. Tommy moved out to LA, was doing great out there, took his brand new daughter and his wife out there, moved out there, and then COVID hit.
Oh boy.
So he had an opportunity. He was out there doing the comedy store and all the cool places and everything. Then COVID hit and just kind of shut it all down for him. He stayed out there for another year. He was like, screw this. He moved back to Houston. So him and I are working on a script called Davy Dash, the story of a champion speedwalker.
So he's one of the comedian. He's one of the guys that
can't
say that Joe Rogan brought him to Texas, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, Tommy's from Texas. Then he went out to L.A. And then, him and Joe pretty much came back at the same time. They were like, I can't stay out here anymore. But he's
and
a great
now
guy.
For the What's in Your Head podcast TikTok lesson of the week.
Hey, everybody. This is a friendly reminder that TikTok isn't real. In that when real people have a problem with somebody, they don't do their makeup, make sure they have a ring light, check their audio levels, and then cry on the internet. If you have a problem with somebody, you address it with them individually. Side note, to everybody out there who's using that audio, you fucking knew! I cherish every single one of you, and it's just proof that the internet does not give a fuck about people's feelings. Making a video like that is the equivalent of standing on the street corner and screaming at the top of your lungs that your wife's meatloaf wasn't good last night. It's ridiculous. Hey, everybody. This is a friendly reminder that TikTok...
And this has been the What's in Your Head podcast TikTok lesson of the week.
I think we're almost down for the news. I'm just... Cat pee, we talked about that. Yep. Oh, I have a story before we get to the news. Fort Myers man arrested for stealing and trying to sell golf carts.
Ah, crap, that story's got... No, just teasing.
North Fort Myers, Florida. North Fort Myers man was arrested for stealing golf carts and trying to sell them. Samuel Rutherford was arrested for grand theft and dealing in stolen property charges, according to the Lee County Sheriff's Office, because they got nothing better to do. Communities along North Cleveland Avenue have been, quote-unquote, plagued with golf cart thefts since January, deputies say. The North District Criminal Investigation Unit started conducting operations to find the suspect and stop the trend. Because after all, golf carts, we've got to keep them. Rutherford became a suspect when the detectives learned that he traded and stolen golf carts at a business in Brooksfield. By the way, that means this guy is stealing golf carts here in North Fort Myers, putting them on a trailer and or in the back of a truck and driving them like 3.5 hours. Brookfield, Florida is not that close. I just lost my place.
I have family that lives in Brookfield.
Yep. Brooksfield was known for years for doing the Brooksfield Raid Civil War reenactment for the longest time, but they cut it off after 30 years. Okay, Brooksfield said the golf cart was worth $5,000 when stolen from the Horizon Village in North Fort Myers on March 3rd. The golf cart was found at the intersection of Lakesville Boulevard and North Cleveland Avenue, tethered to another golf cart, according to investigators. The golf carts were listed for sale with signs and phone numbers. That's smart. The phone numbers belonged to Rutherford, and deputies said they were able to arrange a sales transaction. Rutherford was taken into custody and is at the Lee County Jail, and this guy looks exactly the way you're picturing him.
He got all his teeth?
No, his mouth is closed. He looks like he's probably in his late 50s, balding, and just got the bulldog jaws and just mean mugging the camera because, after all, he did nothing wrong.
All good stories start with Florida man arrested.
Yeah.
That's just sweet. We have radio shows here in Houston, and that they have the Florida Man Arrested segment.
Speaking of Florida Man Arrested segments,
from the Digital 410 West News Desk in Las Vegas, Nevada, Gordon Abernathy.
Gordon, how are you doing tonight?
I am doing good. However, not a Florida man. We have a Florida woman.
Uh-oh.
Woman is accused of killing her boyfriend in an interstate rundown. So wait a second. This is out of Mobile, Alabama, which is making me think that if you're a Florida couple, don't go on a road trip out of state between that and the last horrible incident. A Florida woman is making a cross-country drive with her boyfriend, allegedly let him out on the on Interstate 10 and then intentionally ran him down and killed him. Joanna Cerez, 37, of Miami, was jailed on a charge of murder and the death of Henry Hernandez, 48. The man was found dead early Sunday along Interstate 10 west of Mobile, Alabama. A judge refused to set bond for Cerez on Tuesday after prosecutors said that she has no ties to the area and was a threat to flee.
A flight risk.
But the decision could be reconsidered on a hearing Thursday. So the two were westbound for California, and they spent Saturday night in Mississippi. According to Captain Paul Birch of the Mobile County Sheriff's Office, he said they got up early Sunday and then they headed off in the wrong direction. Oh, I see where this is going. Somebody's going the wrong way. I wasn't listening to her.
Somebody refused to ask for directions, even though that you should have a GPS on your fucking burner phone.
So, California, blah, blah, blah. I lost my spot. Yeah. Oh, there we go. Doggo.
It's usually the time of night Bebop makes an appearance. I don't know where she's at.
It's funny. We said Gordon Oliver. I'm Gordon, and I have a dog named Oliver. So they head in the wrong directions. This, of course, resulted in an argument that ended up with Hernandez getting out of the vehicle, probably because he's angry with his belongings, just miles into Alabama. So she drove away. She didn't get too far away. She turned around after driving away, began traveling westbound on eastbound in the eastbound lanes of I-10, striking him at a high rate of speed and pretty much killing him instantly. So, lesson of the day.
Life choices, choices in life. You might do it once, but you won't do it twice. That is clear. Can you imagine making it to 48 and being in a position that you're with a female companion that has the ability to run your ass down? Something tells me these weren't two quality fine American specimens, if you know what I mean.
Well, and you know that she was intending on killing him because according to the car computer, she was traveling at 73 miles an hour upon impact.
That'll leave a crack in the old windshield.
Yeah, that's called throwing him clear.
Now, not to get too gross or too descript here, but I remember when I lived in Ohio, my ex-wife was borrowing, well, she wasn't my ex-wife then, but she is now. She was borrowing her dad's van, and she was coming back from Kentucky, to which she ran over a deer that had already been ran over, which then left meat and parts on the exhaust pipe, which then the heat generated a nice barbecue smell. When one runs
cooking
over
venison while running down the road,
when one runs over a 48-year-old lover, does that sort of thing happen, and what kind of smell does that produce?
Thanks, dude.
Speaking from experience.
I thought he was 35 when you ran him over.
It is an ongoing case. You guys are history buffs.
Yeah, a little bit.
A helmet worn by Amelia Earhart sells in Cleveland.
I got
how much?
I got to step out of this because I know the answer, so I'll leave it to RJ.
How much did it go for?
Yeah.
100% guess.
Now, hold on. Before you do this, this was a helmet that she wore when she was passengers in training. This wasn't one of the helmets she wore when she did her international flights.
Yeah, she wore the same helmet the following year, Women's Air National Derby, an all-female race in Santa Monica.
Let's see. I'm going to go with, you know, the female thing is really big. I think today was National Women's Day, right? I don't know, maybe.
According to
How
Pornhub.
How much did that go for? I'm going to go for $750,000.
Man, you are close.
Close, I think.
$25K.
I was going to say, I think they...
$825,000.
Oh.
The original reserve was $80,000. They thought that maybe they'd get between $80,000 and $100,000, and it went for $825,000.
Man, if I was on Price is Right, I would have come close to winning both those showcases.
Yeah, but that son of
a
bitch.
That guy would have beat you by a dollar.
I was
going
to say, that motherfucker next to you would have went $1 over.
$350,001.
Oh, that guy. There's always that guy.
Yeah, there's always that guy.
That's the guy whose mom still dresses him at the age of 35.
What's interesting is she wore the same helmet the following year in the Women's National Air Derby, at all-female race from Santa Monica, California to Cleveland. Thousands of spectators had greeted the famous aviator when she landed her single-engine Lockheed Vega in Cleveland Airfield, and she lost the helmet in the crush.
Yeah, I think, of people. Meeting. Yeah, somebody scaffolded it off her head. So basically, the person who paid $825,000 is dealing in stolen property.
Artifacts.
And I'm sure that the people from the Amelia Earhart family would want that back.
Hey, for $825,000, you can have it back. San Diego, California.
Shithole.
I like San Diego, man. It's actually one of the least shitholes of the shitholy cities out there.
It's not saying much.
Well, you know, at least it's a little more red. Anyway, just a authorities seized nearly $3 million of worth of methamphetamine. It was hidden in a shipment of onions.
That old gag.
During the old tractor trailer inspection at the federal facility in San Diego, officials announced on Friday. A canine unit, just saw one pop up on the screen there, for the U.S. Customs and Border Protection alerted to the trailer's shipment of onions on Sunday, where the officers found nearly 1,200 small packages of meth, according to the agency. The 46-year-old driver, a Mexican national who was not named, was arrested for allegedly... Yeah, he doesn't want his head on a fucking pike. Was arrested allegedly for narcotic smuggling attempt at the Ote Mesa Port of Entry commercial vehicle facility. Packages of meth, more than 1,336 pounds, were shipped in small globes of white with white coverings, according to the agency, meant to blend into the onions. The drugs are estimated worth $2.9 million on the street. So, yeah, another fool got caught.
How much were the onions worth, I wonder? I mean,
I don't know the price of vegetables. And
if it was avocados, it may have been close.
And that's what I'm saying. I mean, wow.
And then one more. And this is this goes back to a bronze bell cast in 1834 in Paul Revere's Massachusetts Family Has Come Home.
History with that rock. And me. My team. Been had a little horsey named Paul Revere. Just me and my horsey in a quart of beer.
So capping a nearly two-century cross-country odyssey that said it was hauled by oxcart to churches in Ohio before it languished for decades in a California garage. After a week's-long journey across the U.S., the historical bell was returned Friday to the site where it was created 188 years ago. According to Kylie Nichols, a spokesperson for the Paul Revere Heritage Site located in Canton, just south of Boston, the museum said the 1,000-pound bell was made by the Revolutionary War patriot's son, Joseph Warren Revere, who took over his father's foundry in 1804. In 1984, real estate agent Gene Shanks became the bell's accidental owner. I don't know how you become an accidental owner of a 1,000-pound bell, but hey, there you go. She helped broker sale of the what was once the First Baptist Church in Vermilion, Ohio, to a fitness center, but the gym didn't want the heavy bell, not knowing the historical value, of course. And the Shanks didn't feel good about it being scrapped. So she made a $1,000 donation to the church in exchange for the bell, which earlier had adorned the belfry at the First Presbyterian Church of Cleveland. So when Shanks and her husband Robert retired in Chino Hills, California, they hauled the bell with them. Man,
That's a lot of gas money.
Dragging that thing, you know, especially today, right? It became a joke of the family, said Shanks' daughter, Amy Miller, 66, who is a psychologist in Chino Hills. They opened the door to the garage and ring the bell every 4th of July. People would look at it and say, what the heck is that? Sounds like they had actually a pretty good sense of humor. And some reverence for history. After the parents' death, Miller and her 69-year-old brother, retired Ford Motor Company executive Robert L. Shanks Jr. of Miami, moved the bell to Miller's garage where it sat since 2009. A collector in Texas offered $50,000 for the bell, which bears Revere's imprimatur. But after he casually mentioned he melted down if he decided not to keep it, the siblings spurred on an offer.
Yeah, I was about to say.
So Miller did some online sleuthing, figured out where the bell was forged, and decided to donate it to the Massachusetts Museum so public could view and appreciate it. And that's a good thing they did, because just imagine how much history has just been destroyed out of ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
This concludes the evening news, and now back to the ACT Computer Studio in Cape Coral, Florida.
This episode of the What's in Your Head podcast is brought to you by our friends at ACT Computers. ACT Computers has been providing IT solutions for all of Southwest Florida since 2003, and even if you don't live in Southwest Florida, they can help you via their website and remote login. So give them a call at 239-283-1120 or email them through their Facebook page. Once again, that's 239-283-1120. And if you want to support the show, please head over to whatsinyourhead.com or d-410.com. Click on that Patreon link and sign up. It's only $1 a month, and that dollar goes a long way. And if you haven't done so, please head over to YouTube, look for Digital 410, and like and subscribe. And before we wrap it up, I've been saving my half-assed reviews for the YouTube channel, but I got a half-assed review tonight because I'm wearing a pair of Wrangler jeans. Gordon, how do you feel about Wrangler jeans? Perfectly said.
I have no feelings about them. So.
I had a commercial here. Oh, going back to the 1980s, I was watching this spot tonight, and the best part is at the very end, he picks up like this 19-year-old cowgirl and smacks her on the ass right at the end of the commercial.
Here comes Wrangler. He's one tough customer. He likes life lean and a fit that's clean. Yeah. When he says jeans, he means Wrangler.
Wrangler's honest styles were born in the West to look their best anywhere, top to bottom.
Here comes Wrangler, and he's one tough customer, and he knows what he likes when he sees it.
He said he knows what he likes when he sees it, and it's like this 19-year-old girl in a pair of tight Wranglers he literally smacks on the ass. Reason I bring this up is before the JCPenney went out of sale and I went and bought all their Levi jeans for super cheap, I was buying some Wranglers. I have 3 pairs of Wranglers. They all fit well, but all 3 in the goddamn button has popped off.
Fun fact, Wrangler and Lee are the same company now.
But they need to like double down on the area where the snap goes through. It's the male side. So I have like 3 pairs of Wranglers that I'm going to have the button reapplied to. So just keep that in mind. Maybe pay the extra $20, get yourself a pair of Levi's, because I got a bunch of those and I have no problems with them.
I'm going to wear my Wranglers to the Houston Rodeo Thursday night.
I have not. We have a rodeo out in Lehigh.
You see a lot of chick trucks with the old "I go nuts for Wrangler butt" stickers on the back of their truck there.
Yeah, that's everywhere.
That has got to be everywhere in Texas. It was in Montana.
they have the rodeo out in Lehigh. I've never been because we have a lot of Florida crackers. Carrie's ex husband, interest or ex boyfriend, was actually a bull rider, but go ahead.
I was going to say the rodeo here in Houston. It's a 30-day, I think it's like a 30-day rodeo. And
wow.
Every night. They have a big carnival out there. Then they have, you know, a bunch of vendors out there. Then they do the rodeo. And then following the rodeo, they have a concert. So I think we're going to see Journey, I think.
You're showing your age now.
Well, yeah. Don may not know this, but actually Vegas is a pretty big rodeo town until they lost the national finals rodeo to Texas, but they do still have the PBR Nationals here. So they call that Cowboy Christmas. It happens every December.
You know, that's a big event. Carrie's watching Yellowstone with me. And then did you ever watch the first episode, the first season of The Last Cowboy before they put it on the streaming service, Gordon? Mm-mm. It was put on by the guy who makes Yellowstone, and it was about the cutters, the people you see on the show riding all the horses and shit.
Yeah.
They actually did a full season. It's called The Last Cowboy, and they were following him around, and they made a reality show. It was really cool. Now it's on the streaming service, but, you know, like I said, Carrie's ex-boyfriend was a rider, and she'd go to the rodeo all the time. She's like, I've never seen that cutting stuff before. So apparently Yellowstone's doing a real good job of bringing that shit out of the shadows, because a lot of people weren't familiar with that in the rodeo side, where they make the horses do the slides and all that stuff. That's a pretty damn good show. So if you're interested in that stuff, I think it's on Streaming Plus now.
Well, Don, if you I think Paramount Plus is having a deal for like $1 a month for 3 months. Check out 1883.
Now what you do is you sign up for like the free 70.
Sam Elliott, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that is some of the finest acting I think I've seen Sam Elliott do.
So when are you going to do a period picture there, RJ? When are you going to do a period picture?
You know, I was, Chelsea and I went to Dallas to see Liza. She played Emily in Walking Point. We were having dinner and beers and stuff with her and her husband, Sam. And she's actually doing a Western right now with the guy who played our sergeant, Carl, the Coach Bailey. And I've been following her on Instagram, and she was telling us about it when we're up there. She's out there filming another period piece. She's in love with those things. She loves period pieces.
Sure. She gets to wear all the
cool
dresses.
Am I going to do another one? I have no idea. No idea. I don't know.
We'll have to get together and figure out something. Maybe we'll do a...
Why are you biting me?
I hope you're talking to an animal of some sort. But I think on that note,
15-year-old cat who's not getting enough attention because the Oliver and Cavalier King Charles Spaniel's taking it all. So,
yep. If you leave whiskey in a barrel for several years, the whiskey will get better. But the same is not true for people.
That's going to wrap it up for this episode of the What's in Your Head podcast. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with us. Please like and subscribe on Amazon, Apple Podcasts if you haven't done so. And even better than that, share us with like-minded friends and help get the word out. I want to thank each and every one of you for hanging out with us each week. Thank you, RJ Nevens, for joining us for this week's episode. Thank you, Gordon, for always being here with us. And as always, we will talk to you all next week.
This has been a Digital 410 production.